Colonel Starbottle's Client. By Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 2. Chapter 1. It may be remembered that it was the habit of that gallant war horse of the Calaveras democracy, Colonel Starbottle, at the close of a political campaign, to return to his original profession of the law. Perhaps it could not be called a peaceful retirement. The same fiery-tongued eloquence and full-breasted chivalry which had in turns thrilled and overawed freemen at the polls were no less fervid and embattled before a jury. Yet the colonel was counsel for two or three pastoral ditch companies and certain bucolic corporations, and although he managed to import into the simplest question of contract more or less abuse of opposing counsel, and occasionally mingled precedents of law with antecedents of his adversary, his legal victories were seldom complicated by bloodshed. He was only once shot at by a free-handed judge, and twice assaulted by an oversensitive litigant. Nevertheless, it was thought merely prudent, while preparing the papers in the well-known case of the Arcadian Shepherds Association of Tuolumne versus the Kedron Vine and Fig Tree Growers of Calaveras, that the colonel should seek with a shotgun the seclusion of his partner's law office in the sylvan outskirts of Rough and Ready for that complete rest and serious preoccupation which Marysville could not afford. It was an exceptionally hot day. The painted shingles of the plain wooden one-storied building in which the colonel sat were warped and blistering in the direct rays of the fierce, untempered sun. The tin sign bearing the dazzling legend, Starbottle and Bung Starter, attorneys and counselors, glowed with an insufferable light. The two pine trees still left in the clearing around the house, ineffective as shade, seemed only to have absorbed the day-long heat through every scorched and crisp twig and fiber, to radiate it again with the pungent smell of a slowly smoldering fire. The air was motionless yet vibrating in the sunlight, on distant shallows the half-dried river was flashing and intolerable. Seated in a wooden armchair before a table covered with books and papers, yet with that apparently haughty attitude towards it affected by gentlemen of abdominal fullness, Colonel Starbottle supported himself with one hand grasping the arm of his chair and the other vigorously plying a huge palm leaf fan. He was perspiring freely. He had taken off his characteristic blue frock coat, waistcoat, cravat, and collar, and, stripped only to his ruffled shirt and white drill trousers, presented the appearance from the opposite side of the table of having hastily risen to work in his nightgown. A glass with a thin sediment of sugar and lemon peel remaining in it stood near his elbow. Suddenly a black shadow fell on the staring, uncarpeted hall. It was that of a stranger who had just entered from the noiseless dust of the deserted road. The colonel cast a rapid glance at his sword cane, which lay on the table. But the stranger, although sallow and morose looking, was evidently of pacific intent. He paused on the threshold in a kind of surly embarrassment. "I reckon this is Colonel Starbottle," he said at last, glancing gloomily round him, as if the interview was not entirely of his own seeking. "Well, I've seen you often enough, though you don't know me. My name's Joe Corbin. I guess," he added, still discontentedly, "I have to consult you about something." "Corbin," repeated the colonel in his jauntiest manner. "Ah? Any relation to old Mitch Corbin of Nashville, sir?" "No," said the stranger briefly. "I'm from Shelbyville." "The major," continued the colonel, half closing his eyes as if to follow the major into the dreamy past, "the old major, sir, a matter of 5 or 6 years ago, was one of my most intimate political friends, in fact, sir, my most intimate friend. Take a chair." But the stranger had already taken one, and during the colonel's reminiscence had leaned forward, with his eyes on the ground, discontentedly swinging his soft hat between his legs. "Did you know Tom Frisby, of YOLO?" he asked abruptly. "No. Nor even heard anything about Frisby, nor what happened to him," continued the man, with aggrieved melancholy. In point of fact, the colonel did not think that he had. "Nor anything about his being killed over at Fresno," said the stranger, with a desponding implication that the interview after all was a failure. If you could give me a hint or two," suggested the colonel blandly. "There wasn't much," said the stranger, "if you don't remember." He paused, then rising, He gloomily dragged his chair slowly beside the table, and taking up a paperweight examined it with heavy dissatisfaction. "You see," he went on slowly, "I killed him. It was a quoll. He was my partner, but I reckon he must have drove me hard. Yes, sir," he added with aggrieved reflection, "I reckon he drove me hard." The colonel smiled courteously, slightly expanding his chest under the homicidal relation, as if, having taken it in and made it a part of himself, he was ready, if necessary, to become personally responsible for it. Then lifting his empty glass to the light, he looked at it with half-closed eyes, in polite imitation of his companion's examination of the paperweight, and set it down again. A casual spectator from the window might have imagined that the two were engaged in an amicable inventory of the furniture. "And the actual circumstances?" asked the colonel. "Oh, it was fair enough fight. They'll tell you that. And so would he, I reckon, if he could. He was ugly and bedevilin, but I didn't care to quoll, and give him the go-by all the time. He kept on, followed me out of the shanty, drew, and fired twice." He stopped and regarded his hat a moment as if it was a corroborating witness. I closed with him. I had to. It was my only chance, and that ended it. And with his own revolver. I never drew mine." "I see," said the colonel, nodding, clearly justifiable and honorable as regards the code. "And you wish me to defend you?" The stranger's gloomy expression of astonishment now turned to blank hopelessness. "I knew you didn't understand," he said, despairingly. "Why, all that was 2 years ago. It's all settled and done and gone. The jury found for me at the inquest. It ain't that I want to see you about. It's something arising out of it." "Ah," said the colonel, affably, "a vendetta, perhaps. Some friend or relation of his taken up the quarrel." The stranger looked abstractedly at Starbottle. "You think a relation might, or would feel in that sort of way?" "Why, blank it all, sir," said the colonel, "nothing is more common. Why, in 52 one of my oldest friends, Dr. Byrne, of St. Joe, the seventh in a line from old General Byrne, of St. Louis, was killed, sir, by Pinky Riggs, seventh in a line from Senator Riggs, of Kentucky. Original cause, sir, something about a DD roasting ear, or a blank persimmon in 1832, 47 men wiped out in 20 years. Fact, sir." "It ain't that," said the stranger, moving hesitatingly in his chair. "If it was anything of that sort, I wouldn't mind. It might bring matters to a wind-up, and I shouldn't have to come here and have this cursed talk with you." It was so evident that this frank and unaffected expression of some obscure disgust with his own present position had no other implication, that the colonel did not accept to it. Yet the man did not go on. He stopped and seemed lost in somber contemplation of his hat. The colonel leaned back in his chair, fanned himself elegantly, wiped his forehead with a large pongee handkerchief, and looking at his companion, whose shadowed abstraction seemed to render him impervious to the heat, said, "My dear Mr. Corbin, I perfectly understand you. Blank it all, sir, the temperature in this infernal hole is quite enough to render any confidential conversation between gentlemen upon delicate matters utterly impossible. It's almost as near Hades, sir, as they make it, as I trust you and I, Mr. Corbin, will ever experience. I propose," continued the colonel, with airy geniality, "some light change and refreshment. The barkeeper of the Magnolia is I may say, sir, facile princeps in the concoction of mint juleps, and there is a back room where I have occasionally conferred with political leaders at election time. It is but a step, sir, in fact, on Main Street round the corner." The stranger looked up and then rose mechanically as the colonel resumed his coat and waistcoat, but not his collar and cravat, which lay limp and dejected among his papers. Then, sheltering himself beneath a large-brimmed Panama hat, and hooking his cane on his arm, he led the way, fan in hand, into the road, tiptoeing in his tight, polished boots through the red, impalpable dust with his usual jaunty manner, yet not without a profane suggestion of burning plowshares. The stranger strode in silence by his side in the burning sun, impenetrable in his own morose shadow. But the magnolia was fragrant, like its namesake, with mint and herbal odors, cool with sprinkled floors, and sparkling with broken ice on its counters, like dewdrops on white, unfolded petals, and slightly soporific with the subdued murmur of droning loungers, who were heavy with its sweets. The gallant colonel nodded with confidential affability to the spotless-shirt barkeeper, and then taking Corbin by the arm fraternally conducted him into a small apartment in the rear of the barroom. It was evidently used as the office of the proprietor, and contained a plain desk, table, and chairs. At the rear window, nature, not entirely evicted, looked in with a few straggling buckeyes and a dusty myrtle, over the body of a lately felled pine tree, that flaunted from an upflung branch a still green spray as if it were a drooping banner lifted by a dead but rigid arm. From the adjoining room the faint, monotonous click of billiard balls, languidly played, came at intervals like the dry notes of cicale in the bushes. The barkeeper brought two glasses crowned with mint and diademed with broken ice. The colonel took a long pull at his portion, and leaned back in his chair with a bland gulp of satisfaction and dreamily patient eyes. The stranger mechanically sipped the contents of his glass, and then, without having altered his reluctant expression, drew from his breast pocket a number of old letters. Holding them displayed in his fingers like a difficult hand of cards, and with something of the air of a dispirited player, he began. "You see, about 6 months after this year trouble I got this letter." He picked out a well-worn, badly written missive, and put it into Colonel Starbottle's hands, rising at the same time and leaning over him as he read. "You see, she that writ it says as how she hadn't heard from her son for a long time, but owing to his having spoken once about me, she was emboldened to write and ask me if I knew what had gone of him." He was pointing his finger at each line of the letter as he read it, or rather seemed to translate it from memory with a sad familiarity. "Now," he continued in parenthesis, "you see this kind o' got me. I knew he had got relatives in Kentucky. I knew that all this trouble had been put in the paper with his name and mine, but this here name of Martha Jeffcourt at the bottom didn't seem to jibe with it. Then I remembered that he had left a lot of letters in his trunk in the shanty, and I looked em over. And I found that his name was Tom Jeffcourt, and that he'd been passin' under the name of Frisbee all this time." "Perfectly natural and a frequent occurrence," interposed the colonel cheerfully. "Only last year I met an old friend whom we'll call Stiger, of New Orleans, at the Union Club, Frisco. 'How are you, Stiger?' I said, 'I haven't seen you since we used to meet driving over the Shell Road in 53. "Excuse me, sir," said he, "my name is not Stiger, it's Brown." I looked him in the eye, sir, and saw him quiver. "Then I must apologize to Stiger," I said, "for supposing him capable of changing his name. He came to me an hour after, all in a tremble. 'For God's sake, Star,' he said, 'always called me Star, don't go back on me, but you know family affairs, another woman, beautiful creature, etc., etc.' 'Yes, sir, perfectly common, but a blank mistake. When a man once funks his own name he'll turn tail on anything. Sorry for this man, Freezecoat, or Turncoat, or whatever's his DD name, but it's so.'" The suggestion did not, however, seem to raise the stranger's spirits or alter his manner. "His name was Jeffcourt, and this here was his mother," he went on drearily, "and you see here she says, pointing to the letter again, she's been expecting money from him and it don't come, and she's mighty hard up. And that gave me an idea. I don't know," he went on, regarding the colonel with gloomy doubt, "as you'll think it was much, I don't know as you wouldn't call it a DD fool idea, but I got it all the same." He stopped, hesitated, and went on. "You see, this man, Frisbee, or Jeffcourt, was my partner. We were good friends up to the killing, and then he drove me hard. I think I told you he drove me hard, didn't I? Well, he did. But the idea I got was this. Considerin' I killed him after all, and so to speak disappointed them, I reckoned I'd take upon myself the care of that family and send em money every month. The colonel slightly straightened his clean-shaven mouth. A kind of expiation or amercement by fine, known to the Mosaic, Roman, and Old English law. Gad, sir, the Jews might have made you marry his widow or sister. An old custom, and I think superseded, sir, properly superseded by the alternative of ordeal by battle in the medieval times. I don't myself fancy these pecuniary fashions of settling wrongs, but go on. I wrote her, continued Corbin, that her son was dead, but that he and me had some interests together in a claim, and that I was very glad to know where to send her what would be his share every month. I thought it no use to tell her I killed him, maybe she might refuse to take it. I sent her $100 every month since. Sometimes it's been pretty hard sledding to do it, for I ain't rich, sometimes I've had to borrow the money, but I reckoned that I was only paying for my share in this here business of his bein' dead, and I did it. And I understand you that this Jeffcourt really had no interest in your claim. Corbin looked at him in dull astonishment. Not a cent, of course, I thought I told you that. But that weren't his fault, for he never had anything, and owed me money. In fact, he added gloomily, it was because I hadn't any more to give him having sold my watch for grub that he quolled with me that day, and up and called me a sneakin' Yankee hound. I told you he drove me hard. The colonel coughed slightly and resumed his jaunty manner. And the ER mother was, of course, grateful and satisfied. Well, no, not exactly. He stopped again and took up his letters once more, sorted and arranged them as if to play out his unfinished but hopeless hand, and drawing out another, laid it before the colonel. You see, this Mrs. Jeffcourt, after a time, reckoned she ought to have more money than I sent her, and wrote saying that she had always understood from her son, he that never wrote but once a year, remember, that this claim of ours, that she never knew of, you know, was paying much more than I sent her, and she wanted a return of accounts and papers, or she'd write to some lawyer, mighty quick. Well, I reckoned that all this was naturally in the line of my trouble, and I did manage to scrape together $50 more for 2 months and sent it. But that didn't seem to satisfy her, as you see. He dealt Colonel Starbottle another letter from his baleful hand with an unchanged face. When I got that, well, I just up and told her the whole thing. I sent her the account of the fight from the newspapers, and told her as how her son was the frisbee that was my partner, and how he never had a cent in the world, but how I'd got that idea to help her, and was willing to carry it out as long as I could. Did you keep a copy of that letter? Asked the colonel, straightening his mask-like mouth. No, said Corbin moodily. What was the good? I knowed she'd got the letter, and she did, for that is what she wrote back. He laid another letter before the colonel, who hastily read a few lines and then brought his fat white hand violently on the desk. Why, d'n it all, sir, this is blackmail. As infamous a case of threatening and chantage as I ever heard of. Well, said Corbin, dejectedly, I don't know. You see, she allows that I murdered Frisbee to get hold of his claim, and that I'm trying to buy her off, and that if I don't come down with $20,000 on the nail, and notes for the rest, she'll prosecute me. Well, mebbe the thing looks to her like that, mebbe you know I've got to shoulder that too. Perhaps it's all in the same line. Colonel Starbottle for a moment regarded Corbin critically. In spite of his chivalrous attitude towards the homicidal faculty, the colonel was not optimistic in regard to the baser pecuniary interests of his fellow man. It was quite on the cards that his companion might have murdered his partner to get possession of the claim. It was true that Corbin had voluntarily assumed an unrecorded and hitherto unknown responsibility that had never been even suspected, and was virtually self-imposed. But that might have been the usual one unerring blunder of criminal sagacity and forethought. It was equally true that he did not look or act like a mean murderer, but that was nothing. However, there was no evidence of these reflections in the colonel's face. Rather, he suddenly beamed with an excess of politeness. Would you ER mind, Mr. Corbin, whilst I am going over those letters again, to step across to my office and bring me the copy of Wood's Digest that lies on my table? It will save some time. The stranger rose, as if the service was part of his self-imposed trouble, and as equally hopeless with the rest, and taking his hat departed to execute the commission. As soon as he had left the building, Colonel Starbottle opened the door and mysteriously beckoned the barkeeper within. "Do you remember anything of the killing of a man named Frisbee over in Fresno 3 years ago?" The barkeeper whistled meditatively. "3 years ago, Frisbee, Fresno, no?" "Yes, but that was only one of his names. He was Jack Walker over here." "Yes, and by Jove, that feller that was here with you killed him. Darn my skin, but I thought I recognized him." "Yes, yes, I know all that," said the colonel, impatiently. "But did Frisbee have any property? Did he have any means of his own?" "Property," echoed the barkeeper with scornful incredulity. "Property? Means? The only property and means he ever had was the free lunches or drinks he took in at somebody else's expense. Why, the only chance he ever had of earning a square meal was when that fellow that was with you just now took him up and made him his partner. And the only way he could get rid of him was to kill him. And I didn't think he had it in him. Rather a queer kind o' chap, good deal of hayseed about him. Showed up at the inquest so glum and orchard that if the boys hadn't made up their minds this year Frisbee order been killed, it might have gone hard with him." "Mr. Corbin," said Colonel Starbottle, with a pained but unmistakable hauteur and a singular elevation of his shirt frill, as if it had become of its own accord erectile, "Mr. Corbin is the distant relative of old Major Corbin, of Nashville one of my oldest political friends. When Mr. Corbin returns, you can conduct him to me. And, if you please, replenish the glasses." When the barkeeper respectfully showed Mr. Corbin and Wood's Digest into the room again, the colonel was still beaming and apologetic. "A thousand thanks, sir, but except to show you the law if you require it, hardly necessary. I have glanced over the woman's letters again. It would be better, perhaps, if you had kept copies of your own, but still these tell the whole story and your own. The claim is preposterous. You have simply to drop the whole thing. Stop your remittances, stop your correspondence, pay no heed to any further letters and wait results. You need fear nothing further, sir, I stake my professional reputation on it." The gloom of the stranger seemed only to increase as the colonel reached his triumphant conclusion. "I reckoned you'd say that," he said slowly, "but it won't do. I shall go on paying as far as I can. It's my trouble and I'll see it through. But, my dear sir, consider," gasped the colonel. "You are in the hands of an infamous harpy, who is using her son's blood to extract money from you. You have already paid a dozen times more than the life of that DD sneak was worth, and more than that, the longer you keep on paying you are helping to give color to their claim and stopping your own defense. And gad, sir, you're making a precedent for this sort of thing. You are offering a premium to widows and orphans. A gentleman won't be able to exchange shots with another without making himself liable for damages. I am willing to admit that your feelings, though, in my opinion, are exaggerated, do you credit, but I am satisfied that they are utterly misunderstood, sir." "Not by all of them," said Corbin darkly. "Eh," returned the colonel quickly. "There was another letter here which I didn't particularly point out to you," said Corbin, taking up the letters again, "for I reckoned it wasn't evidence, so to speak, being from his cousin, a girl, and calculated you'd read it when I was out." The colonel coughed hastily. "I was in fact just about to glance over it when you came in. It was written," continued Corbin, selecting a letter more bethumbed than the others, "after the old woman had threatened me. This here young woman allows that she is sorry that her aunt has to take money of me on account of her cousin being killed, and she is still sorrier that she is so bitter against me. She says she hadn't seen her cousin since he was a boy, and used to play with her, and that she finds it hard to believe that he should ever grow up to change his name and act so as to provoke anybody to lift a hand against him. She says she supposed it must be something in that dreadful California that alters people and makes everybody so reckless. I reckon her head's level there, ain't it? There was such a sudden and unexpected lightening of the man's face as he said it, such a momentary relief to his persistent gloom, that the colonel, albeit inwardly dissenting from both letter and comment, smiled condescendingly. She's no slouch of a scribe neither, continued Corbin animatedly. Read that? He handed his companion the letter, pointing to a passage with his finger. The colonel took it with, I fear, a somewhat lowered opinion of his client, and a new theory of the case. It was evident that this week's admission to the aunt's conspiracy was only the result of a greater weakness for the niece. Colonel Starbottle had a wholesome distrust of the sex as a business or political factor. He began to look over the letter, but was evidently slurring it with superficial politeness, when Corbin said, "Read it out loud." The colonel slightly lifted his shoulders, fortified himself with another sip of the julep, and, leaning back, oratorically began to read the stranger leaning over him and following line by line with shining eyes. When I say I am sorry for you, it is because I think it must be dreadful for you to be going round with the blood of a fellow creature on your hands. It must be awful for you in the stillness of the night season to hear the voice of the Lord saying, Cain, where is thy brother, and you saying, Lord, I have slayed him dead. It must be awful for you when the pride of your wrath was surfeit, and his dumb senseless core was before you, not to know that it is written, Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. It was no use for you to say, I never heard that before, remembering your teacher and parents. Yet verily I say unto you, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be washed whiter than snow, saith the Lord. Isaiah 1, 18, and heart hath no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. My hymn book, First Presbyterian Church, page 79. Mr. Corbin, I pity your feelings at the grave of my poor dear cousin, knowing he is before his Maker, and you can't bring him back. Umph, er, very good indeed, said the colonel, hastily refolding the letter. Very well meaning and er. Go on, said Corbin over his shoulder, you haven't read all. Ah, true. I perceive I overlooked something. May God forgive you, Mr. Corbin, as I do, and make on to think better of you, for it was good what you tried to do for her and the family, and I've always said it when she was raging round and wanting money of you. I don't believe you meant to do it anyway, owing to your kindness of heart to the orphanless and the widow since you did it. Answer this letter, and don't mind what Aunt says. So no more at present from yours very respectfully, Sally Dowse. P.S. There's been some trouble in our township, and some fightin'. May the Lord change their hearts and make them as a little child, for if you are still young you may grow up different. I have writ a short prayer for you to say every night. You can copy it out and put it at the head of your bed. It is this, O Lord, make me sorry for having killed Sarah Dow's cousin. Give me, O Lord, that peace that the world cannot give, and which fadeth not away, for my yoke is heavy, and my burden is harder than I can bear. The colonel's deliberate voice stopped. There was a silence in the room, and the air seemed stifling. The click of the billiard balls came distinctly through the partition from the other room. Then there was another click, a stamp on the floor, and a voice crying coarsely, "Curse it all!" missed again. To the stranger's astonishment, the colonel was on his feet in an instant, gasping with inarticulate rage. Flinging the door open, he confronted the startled barkeeper and purpled and stertorous. "Blank it all, sir, do you call this a saloon for gentlemen, or a corral for swearing cattle? Or do you mean to say that the conversation of two gentlemen upon delicate professional and domestic affairs is to be broken upon by the blank profanity of low-bred hounds over their picayune gambling? Take them my kyard, sir," choked the colonel, who was always southern and dialectic in his excited as in his softest moments, "and tell them that Colonel Starbottle will never diearken these does again." Before the astonished barkeeper could reply, the colonel had dashed back into the room, clapped his hat on his head, and seized his book, letters, and cane. "Mr. Corbin," he said with gasping dignity, "I will take these papers, and consult them again in my own office where, if you will do me the honor, sir, to call at 10 o'clock tomorrow, I will give you my opinion." He strode out of the saloon beside the half-awe-stricken, half-amused, yet all discreetly silent loungers, followed by his wondering but gloomy client. At the door they parted, the colonel tiptoeing towards his office as if dancing with rage, the stranger darkly plodding through the stifling dust in the opposite direction, with what might have been a faint suggestion to his counselor, that the paths of the homicide did not lie beside the still cool waters. Chapter 2. The house of Captain Masterton Dowse, at Pineville, Kentucky, was a fine specimen of Southern classical architecture, being an exact copy of Major Fauquier's house in Virginia, which was in turn only a slight variation from a well-known statesman's historical villa in Alabama, that everybody knew was designed from a famous Greek temple on the Piraeus. Not but that it shared this resemblance with the county courthouse and the Odd Fellows Hall, but the addition of training jessamine and Cherokee rose to the columns of the portico, and over the colonnade leading to its offices, showed a certain domestic distinction. And the skyline of its incongruously high roof was pleasantly broken against adjacent green pines, butternut, and darker cypress. A nearer approach showed the stuccoed gateposts whose red brick core was revealed through the dropping plaster opening in a wall of half-rough stone, half-wooden palisade, equally covered with shining moss and parasitical vines, which hid a tangled garden left to its own unkempt luxuriance. Yet there was a reminiscence of past formality and even pretentiousness in a wide box-bordered terrace and one or two stuccoed vases prematurely worn and time-stained, while several rare exotics had, however, thriven so unwisely and well in that stimulating soil as to lose their exclusive refinement and acquire a certain temporary vulgarity. A few, with the not uncommon enthusiasm of aliens, had adopted certain native peculiarities with a zeal that far exceeded any indigenous performance. But dominant through all was the continual suggestion of precocious fruition and premature decay that lingered like a sad perfume in the garden, but made itself persistent if less poetical in the house. Here the fluted wooden columns of the portico and colonnade seemed to have taken upon themselves a sodden and unwholesome age unknown to stone and mortar. Moss and creeper clung to paint that time had neither dried nor mellowed, but left still glary in its white consistency. There were rusty red blotches around inflamed nail holes in the swollen wood, as of punctures in living flesh, along the entablature and cornices and in the dank gutters decay had taken the form of a mild deliquescence, and the pillars were spotted as if nature had dropped over the too early ruin a few unclean tears. The house itself was lifted upon a broad wooden foundation painted to imitate marble with such hopeless mendacity that the architect at the last moment had added a green border, and the owner permitted a fallen board to remain off so as to allow a few privileged fowls to openly explore the interior. When Miss Sally Dowse played the piano in the drawing room, she was at times accompanied by the uplifted voice of the sympathetic hounds who sought its quiet retreat in ill health or low spirits, and from whom she was separated only by an imperfectly carpeted floor of yawning seams. The infant progeny of Mammy Judy, an old nurse, made this a hiding place from domestic justice, where they were eventually betrayed by subterranean giggling that had once or twice brought bashful confusion to the hearts of Miss Sally's admirers, and mischievous security to that finished coquette herself. It was a pleasant September afternoon, on possibly one of these occasions, that Miss Sally, sitting before the piano, alternately striking a few notes with three pink fingers and glancing at her reflection in the polished rosewood surface of the lifted keyboard case, was heard to utter this languid protest. "Quit that kind of talk, Chet, unless you just admire to have every word of it repeated all over the county. Those little racial expletives of Mammy Judy's are lying round somewhere and are mighty cute, and sassy, I tell you. It's nothing to me, sure, but Miss Hilda might auntie like to hear of it. So soon after your particular attention to her at last night's potty too." Here a fresh-looking young fellow of 26, leaning uneasily over the piano from the opposite side, was heard to murmur that he didn't care what Miss Hilda heard, nor the whole world, for the matter of that. But, he added, with a faint smile, folks allow that you know how to play up sometimes, and put on the loud pedal, when you don't want Mammy's racial expletives to hear. Indeed, said the young lady demurely. Like this. She put out a distracting little foot, clothed in the white stocking and cool black prunella slipper then de rigueur in the state, and, pressing it on the pedal, began to drum vigorously on the keys. In vain the amorous Chet protested in a voice which the instrument drowned. Perceiving which the artful young lady opened her blue eyes mildly and said, I reckon it is so, it does kind of prevent you hearing what you don't want to hear. You know well enough what I mean, said the youth gloomily. And that ain't all that folks say. They allow that you're doing a heap too much correspondence with that Californian rough that killed Tom Jeffcourt over there. Do they? Said the young lady, with a slight curl of her pretty lip. Then perhaps they allow that if it wasn't for me he wouldn't be sending $100 a month to Aunt Martha. Yes, said the fatuous youth, but they allow he killed Tom for his money. And they do say it's mighty queer doin's in yo write in religious letters to him, and Tom your own cousin. Oh, they tell those lies here, do they? But do they say anything about how, when the same lies were told over in California, the lawyer they've got over there, called Colonel Starbottle a southern man too got up and just wrote to Aunt Martha that she'd better quit that afore she got prosecuted? They didn't tell you that, did they, Mr. Chester Brooks? But here the unfortunate Brooks, after the fashion of all jealous lovers, deserted his allies for his fair enemy. I don't cotton to what they say, Sally, but you do write to him, and I don't see what you've got to write about you and him. Jule Jeffcourt says that when you got religion at Louisville during the revival, you felt you had a call to write and save sinners, and you did that as your trial and probation, but that since you backslided and are worldly again, and go to parties, you just keep it up for foolin' and flirtin'. She ain't goin' to weaken on the man that shot her brother, just because he's got a gold mine and a mustache. She takes his money all the same, said Miss Sally. She don't her mother does. She says if she was a man she'd have blood for blood. My, said Miss Sally, in affected consternation. It's a wonder she don't apply to you to act for her. If it was my brother he killed, I'd challenge him quick enough, said Chet, flushing through his thin pink skin and light hair. Marry her, then, and that'll make you one of the family. I reckon Miss Hilda can bear it, rejoined the young lady pertly. Look here, Miss Sally, said the young fellow with a boyish despair that was not without a certain pathos in its implied inferiority, I ain't gifted like you, I ain't on yo level know-how, I can't pass yo on the road, and so I reckon I must take yo dust as yo make it. But there is one thing, Miss Sally, I want to tell you. You know what's going on in this country, you've heard your father say what the opinion of the best men is, and what's likely to happen if the Yanks force that racial expletive worshipper, Lincoln, on the South. You know that we're drawing the line closer every day, and spotting the men that ain't sound. Take care, Miss Sally, you ain't selling us cheap to some northern abolitionist who'd like to set Marm Judy's little racial expletives to something worse than eavesdropping down there, and maybe teach em to kindle a fire underneath yo own flow. He had become quite dialectic in his appeal, as if youthfully reverting to some accent of the nursery, or as if he were exhorting her in some recognized shibboleth of a section. Miss Sally rose and shut down the piano. Then leaning over it on her elbows, her rounded little chin slightly elevated with languid impertinence, and one saucy foot kicked backwards beyond the hem of her white cotton frock, she said, and let me tell you, Mr. Chester Brooks, that it's just such godforsaken, infant phenomenons as you who want to run the whole country that make all this fuss, when you ain't no more fit to be trusted with matches than Judy's children. What do you know of Mr. Joe Corbin, when you don't even know that he's from Shelbyville, and as good a Southerner as you, and if he hasn't got racial expletives it's because they don't use them in his parts. You are for all the world like one o' Mrs. Johnson's fancy bantams that ain't quit of the shell afore they square off at their own mother. My goodness. Show. Show-o-o. And suiting the action to the word the young lady, still indolently, even in her simulation, swirled around, caught her skirts at the side with each hand, and lazily shaking them before her in the accepted feminine method of frightening chickens as she retreated backwards, dropped them suddenly in a profound curtsy and swept out of the parlor. Nevertheless, as she entered the sitting room she paused to listen, then, going to the window, peeped through the slits of the Venetian blind and saw her youthful admirer, more dejected in the consciousness of his wasted efforts and useless attire, mount his showy young horse, as aimlessly spirited as himself, and ride away. Miss Sally did not regret this, neither had she been entirely sincere in her defense of her mysterious correspondent. But, like many of her sex, she was trying to keep up by the active stimulus of opposition an interest that she had begun to think if left to itself might wane. She was conscious that her cousin Julia, although impertinent and illogical, was right in considering her first epistolary advances to Corbin as a youthful convert's religious zeal. But now that her girlish enthusiasm was spent, and the revival itself had proved as fleeting an excitement as the old tournament of love and beauty, which it had supplanted, she preferred to believe that she enjoyed the fascinating impropriety because it was the actual result of her religious freedom. Perhaps she had a vague idea that Corbin's conversion would expiate her present preference for dress and dancing. She had certainly never flirted with him, they had never exchanged photographs, there was not a passage in his letters that might not have been perused by her parents, which, I fear, was probably one reason why she had never shown her correspondence, and beyond the fact that this letter writing gave her a certain importance in her own eyes and those of her companions, it might really be stopped. She even thought of writing at once to him that her parents objected to its further continuance, but remembering that his usual monthly letter was now nearly due, she concluded to wait until it came. It is to be feared that Miss Sally had little help in the way of family advice, and that the moral administration of the Dow's household was as prematurely developed and as precociously exhausted as the estate and mansion themselves. Captain Dow's marriage with Josephine Jeffcourt, the daughter of a poor white, had been considered a mésalliance by his family, and his own sister, Miranda Dow's, had abandoned her brother's roof and refused to associate with the Jeffcourts, only returning to the house and an armed neutrality at the death of Mrs. Dow's a few years later. She had taken charge of Miss Sally, sending her to school at Nashville until she was recalled by her father 2 years ago. It may be imagined that Miss Sally's correspondence with Jeffcourt's murderer had afforded her a mixed satisfaction. It was at first asserted that Miss Sally's forgiveness was really prompted by Miss Mirandy, as a subtle sarcasm upon the family. When, however, that forgiveness seemed to become a source of revenue to the impoverished Jeffcourts, her Christian interference had declined. For this reason, possibly, the young girl did not seek her aunt in the bedroom, the dining room, or the business room, where Miss Miranda frequently assisted Captain Dow's in the fatuous and prejudiced mismanagement of the house and property, nor in any of the vacant guest rooms, which, in their early wreck of latter-day mahogany and rosewood, seemed to have been unoccupied for ages, but went directly to her own room. This was in the L, a lately added wing that had escaped the gloomy architectural tyranny of the main building, and gave Miss Sally light, ventilation, the freshness and spice of new pine boards and clean paper, and a separate entrance and windows on a cool veranda all to herself. Intended as a concession to the young lady's traveled taste, it was really a reversion to the finer simplicity of the pioneer. New as the apartment appeared to be, it was old enough to contain the brief little records of her maidenhood, the childish samplers and pictures, the sporting epoch with its fox heads, opossum and wildcat skins, riding whip, and the goshawk in a cage, which Miss Sally believed could be trained as a falcon, the religious interval of illustrated texts, Rock of Ages, cardboard crosses, and the certificate of her membership with the Daughters of Zion at the head of her little bed, down to the last decadence of frivolity shown in the beribboned guitar in the corner, and the dance cards, favors, and rosettes, military buttons, dried bouquets, and other love gauges on the mantelpiece. The young girl opened a drawer of her table and took out a small packet of letters tied up with a green ribbon. As she did so, she heard the sound of hoofs in the rear courtyard. This was presently followed by a step on the veranda, and she opened the door to her father with the letters still in her hand. There was neither the least embarrassment nor self-consciousness in her manner. Captain Dawes, superficially remarkable only for a certain odd combination of high military stock and turned-over planter's collar, was slightly exalted by a sympathetic mingling of politics and mint julep at Pineville Courthouse. "I was passing by the post office at the crossroads last week, dear," he began, cheerfully, "and I thought of you, and reckoned it was about time that my pussy got one of her letters from her rich Californian friend, and sure enough there was one. I clean forgot to give it to you then, and only remembered it passing there today. I didn't get to see if there was any gold dust in it," he continued, with great archness, and a fatherly pinch of her cheek, "though I suspect that isn't the kind of currency he sends to you." "It is from Mr. Corbin," said Miss Sally, taking it with a languid kind of doubt, "and only now, Pa, I was just thinking that I'd sort of drop writing any more. It makes a good deal of buzzing amongst the neighbors, and I don't see much honey nor comb in it." "Eh," said the captain, apparently more astonished than delighted at his daughter's prudence. "Well, child, suit yourself. It's mighty mean, though, for I was just thinking of telling you that Judge Reed is an old friend of this Colonel Starbottle, who is your friend's friend and lawyer, and he says that Colonel Starbottle is with U.S., and working for the cause out there, and has got a list of all the Southern men in California that are sound and solid for the South. Reed says he shouldn't wonder if he'd make California will into line too." "I don't see what that's got to do with Mr. Corbin," said the young girl, impatiently, flicking the still unopened letter against the packet in her hand. "Well," said the captain, with cheerful vagueness, "I thought it might interest you, that's all," and lounged judicially away. "Pa thinks," said Miss Sally, still standing in the doorway, ostentatiously addressing her pet goshawk, but with one eye following her retreating parent, "Pa thinks that everybody is as keen bent on politics as he is. There's where Pa slips up, Jim." Re-entering the room, scratching her little nose thoughtfully with the edge of Mr. Corbin's letter, she went to the mantelpiece and picked up a small ivory-handled dagger, the gift of Joyce Masterton, aged 18, presented with certain verses addressed to a daughter of the South, and cut open the envelope. The first glance was at her own name, and then at the signature. There was no change in the formality. It was "Dear Miss Sarah, and yours respectfully, Joe Corbin," as usual. She was still secure. But her pretty brows contracted slightly as she read as follows: "I've always allowed I should feel easier in my mind if I could ever get to see Mrs. Jeff Court, and that maybe she might feel easier in hers if I stood before her, face to face. Even if she didn't forgive me at once, it might do her good to get off what she had on her mind against me. But as there wasn't any chance of her coming to me, and it was out of the question my coming to her and still keeping up enough work in the mines to send her the regular money, it couldn't be done. But at last I've got a partner to run the machine when I'm away. I shall be at Shelbyville by the time this reaches you, where I shall stay a day or two to give you time to break the news to Mrs. Jeff Court, and then come on. You will do this for me in your Christian kindness, Miss Dawes, won't you? And if you could soften her mind so as to make it less hard for me, I shall be grateful. P.S. I forgot to say I have had him exhumed, you know who I mean, and am bringing him with me in a patent metallic burial casket, the best that could be got in Frisco, and will see that he is properly buried in your own graveyard. It seemed to me that it would be the best thing I could do, and might work upon her feelings as it has on mine. Don't you, J.C.?" Miss Sally felt the tendrils of her fair hair stir with consternation. The letter had arrived a week ago. Perhaps he was in Pineville at that very moment. She must go at once to the Jeff Courts. It was only a mile distant. Perhaps she might be still in time, but even then it was a terribly short notice for such a meeting. Yet she stopped to select her newest hat from the closet, and to tie it with the largest of bows under her pretty chin, and then skipped from the veranda into a green lane that ran beside the garden boundary. There, hidden by a hedge, she dropped into a long, swinging trot, that even in her haste still kept the languid deliberation characteristic of her people, until she had reached the road. Two or three hounds in the garden started joyously to follow her, but she drove them back with a portentous frown, and an ill-aimed stone, and a suppressed voice. Yet in that backward glance she could see that her little Eumenides Mammy Judy's children were peering at her from below the wooden floor of the portico, which they were grasping with outstretched arms and bowed shoulders, as if they were black caryatides supporting, as indeed their race had done for many a year, the predoomed and decaying mansion of their master.